Data tables are great for conducting what-if analyses that involve either one or two inputs. However, some business problems involve more than two input values. For example, suppose that you want to evaluate three different break-even analyses. The first one would show the worst case of us lowering the selling price and decreasing the projected sales. The second break-even analysis could portray likely values that include keeping the current selling price in C9 and a projected realistic sales volume here in C8. The third analysis will show us a best case scenario that has us increasing the selling price and increasing our sales. I wonder what that would do to our profits. Each one of these different analyses will require adjusting the marketing budget because it would probably be pretty tough to just raise our prices arbitrarily and have more people buy our swimsuits without spending some money to convince them that the extra money is worth it to buy our swimsuits. To do this, we could create three models and three different marketing budgets and have each one of those have their own unique different data tables like we did in the previous video, and then vary the selling price and unit sales values. But that sounds kind of messy, and we'd have a tough time comparing all of those cells from one data table to another and the other. Instead of that, we'll use what Excel calls the scenario manager to perform our different what-if analyses. A scenario is a set of values stored in a worksheet that can be varied to describe different situations. In our example, we want to vary several different values in our three different situations, or scenarios, which we'll call them worst case, likely, and best case. We'll use that scenario manager to define and save these sets of values as scenarios. You can then easily view and change them as necessary to produce and compare different result sets. You can even create a snazzy summary report that lists all of the values contained in the summary side by side for easy comparison. And of course, because everything that's cool has pivot tables in it, there's also a pivot table report. To create a scenario, you need to plan out the input data that you want to use, as well as the output or result cells that you want included in your final report. Planning is everything here. In the swimwear worksheet, we have a set of assumptions over here. These will be our input values. In the scenario manager, these cells are referred to as the changing cells. The output cells, these cells over here in our projections area, will be referred to as the result cells. The scenario manager requires that all of the cells used in it are located on the same worksheet, so a scenario cannot span across multiple worksheets, so you have to plan for that. In this worksheet, we have the projected income statement for our existing swimwear lines, men's racers, men's trunks, women's one-piece racers, and women's two-piece suits. What we're going to try to evaluate is the result on profitability if we vary the marketing campaign budgets across our different product lines. What do we want to spend our money on, and in what proportion? In addition to our overall profitability, we want to see what effect that variation will have on all of our projected values over here. The numbers that we currently have here in our unit sold cells are our sales from the previous year rounded to the nearest 1,000. The cost of goods sold and the distribution are all current prices. In cell F19, we have the estimated overhead expense for the swimsuit product category. We have a current marginal tax rate of 35%, so over here in our projections area, we'll calculate our estimated taxes by multiplying our pre-tax income by that 35%. Please note that the current progressive tax structure in the U.S. is much more complicated than this, and if we use just that formula, if we have a negative pre-tax income up here, it calculates that the government will actually give us money back, and that's not likely to happen, so I'll wrap that formula in an if statement so that it only runs the calculation if the income is positive. Equals if this number is positive, then that formula runs. If it's false that value is positive, then they get zero. Also note that the total payroll at estimated units sold is a fairly complicated formula as well, but we've learned how to do this previously, so we should be able to just crank this out. Based upon last year's sales, our HR and production operation managers calculated that it took 5 employees, each earning $38,500, to produce up to 200,000 units. The operations manager forecasts that if the units produced exceeded 200,000 units, The equivalent of one half of a full-time employee would have to be added for each additional 50,000 units produced. The stepped variable relationship is produced down here in this table from B23 to C29. A stepped variable relationship is one where the cost to produce an item does not vary directly with each number of units sold, but rather the cost will vary with steps of quantities as reflected in this awesome table. Remembering our skills from Lesson 5, we can use the VLOOKUP function here in F17 to determine the number of employees needed to produce all of the units that are sold up here in these four cells. Once we calculate the number of employees, we can use this formula in F18 to calculate our payroll for these 5+ production workers. F19 contains our overhead, such as rent, utilities, and other salaries not related to the production of the swimsuits. Now over here on the projection side, as you hopefully recall, contribution margin represents the amount of income that contributes to covering the fixed expenses of our company. In order to calculate the income from the sales of these four products, we would have to do something crazy like multiply this cell by $39.95 and then add that to this cell times $49.95 and then add that cell times $44.95, etc. for every different product category. Now, while that isn't a horrendous formula because we only have four product categories, it is a good time to introduce you to a very handy shortcut function called the sum product. The sum product function takes arrays of cells, multiplies the array elements together, and then adds them up for us. So if we add this unit sold range of our cells as the first array and the unit sales price as our second array, this multiplies the first elements of the two arrays, this cell and this cell, and then adds them together to the second elements of our arrays, this cell and this cell, etc., until it gets to the end of the array, at which time it gives us our correct answer. We can then similarly apply that function to our situations here for all of our variable incomes and expenses. For cost of goods sold and for our distribution expenses, we just substitute the arrays for the cost of goods sold and distribution expense cells in lieu of our sales price array, and we're almost good to go. I'm going to vary from the book here by making these two cells negative since their expenses and their cash flow is technically negative. That simplifies this contribution margin calculation to just having to sum these two cells, as opposed to the book that asks us to take this number and then subtract this one and then subtract this one. Let's follow some best practices, folks. Down here, we have our fixed and stepped expenses, all with a negative sign in front of them so that their cash flow is correct. And we add all these together here. The marginal income before tax is then the contribution margin added to the total fixed expenses cells. We talked about the taxes earlier, so that cell is all good to go as well. Finally, we have the marginal net income down here, and we're good to move on. Now that we understand how the worksheet is actually constructed, we're ready to get moving on our scenarios. Based upon market research, staff in the marketing department has estimated and forecasted the sales for these four options shown in the marketing and sales estimate worksheet. As you see here, option one focuses on marketing the men's trunks, which are sold primarily in discount and low-level retailers. Not judging, but evidently men don't care what they look like at the beach, so they can buy as cheaply as they want to. But I digress. Option 2 examines expending the men's and women's racing lines in college outlets. Option 3 examines spending more on the women's two-piece suit campaign, which are usually sold in high-end retailers. Finally, option 4 considers expanding the market for all four styles, but in a more balanced approach. If you look at the numbers here, notice in this last approach, there appears to be some carryover across the categories. For instance, here in the high-end option 3, we spent $5,000 in order to sell 5,000 units. But if we balance our marketing across all categories evidently benefit from the increased product awareness, and that category jumps up to $9,000 for the same $5,000 spent on the same category in that channel. We've also been told by the purchasing staff that because of the zone's long-term contracts that our costs for inventory and distribution expenses will remain the same for the coming year. Human Resources has informed us that due to increases in healthcare insurance, our cost per manufacturing employee will need to rise to 39,100, and overhead will stay approximately the same. There have not been any rumors about changes in the marginal tax rate, so we'll keep that constant as well. We now have all of the information we need in order to set up our scenarios. We're going to set up 5 different scenarios, one for the current marketing plan that contains all the values in all these cells currently, and then additional ones for each of these here. Before we create these scenarios, we need to determine the changing cells in the worksheet and give each one of them a name. In other words, which input assumptions might we want to change in each scenario? Even if we don't want to change them, if we want them to appear in our report, we need to look at them and make sure they're named appropriately. Excel allows up to 32 different changing cells in each scenario, so as long as we stay below 32 different cells, we're good to go. I've defined all the names that we're going to use for our changing and result cells over here on a tab called Define Names. In this worksheet, I have all of the changing and result cells that I want to name here in column A and the names that I want to set them to. Now, when referring to these cells in formulas or reports, I'll be referring to their defined name instead of their cell number. Also, by using their names in the reports, that name will appear on the report instead of the cell number, and you'll see how useless that is in a couple minutes. Let's discuss defined names for a moment. All defined names have what's referred to as a scope, which specifies the location or locations where that name is valid. A defined name can have a scope of the entire workbook, so any formula or report on any sheet can refer to that name. This scope is sometimes referred to as a global scope. Alternatively, a name can have a scope for just one individual sheet. This is sometimes referred to as a local scope. Each name must be unique within its scope. For example, we might have a cell called Ken's Pay with a value of $100,000 in it, and if it had a global scope, any formula on any sheet that refers to Ken's Pay will receive the value of $100,000. When you use the cell naming area up here to name your cell or cell range, note that it will always make the name have a global scope. I can confirm this up in the Name Manager on the Formulas tab. However, if we had 3 sheets and I wanted each sheet to have a named cell called Ken's Pay, each of these 3 cells would need to have a local scope because we can't have multiple Ken's Pay names that are all global. Each name can only be used once within its scope. In order to make a named cell with a local scope, we have to do something a little different other than use this little named area over here. You'll see that in each one of these sheets, in cell B1, I put a number that constitutes a salary for that particular page. For each one, I click on that cell and then go up to Formulas, Define Name, enter in Ken's Pay, and then define that scope to that worksheet, Sheet 1. Let me quickly do that for all 3 sheets. Now if I want to refer to any of those names from a different sheet, say that I wanted to average those 3 values on those 3 sheets here on this page, I would refer to them each individually in the formula like we learned how to do back in level 1 by typing in equals average sheet 1 exclamation point Ken's Pay, comma, sheet 2 exclamation mark, Ken's Pay, sheet 3, exclamation point, Ken's Pay, close the parentheses, and there you go. So we're finally ready to create our scenarios, but alas, we're out of time, so I'll see you in the next video.